Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Strong Supply Chains Through Resilient Operations, Five Principles for Leaders to Win in a Volatile World. By Suketu Gandhi, Michael F. Strohmer, Marc Lakner, Tiffany Hickerson, and Sherri. Narrated by Stephen R. Thorne. Limit of Liability / Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including, but not limited to, special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Preface. Building strong supply chains to profit despite disruptions. A company's products, services, strategy, and customers are all important. But the supply chain behind all of this delivers to customers the value they were promised. Supply chains are receiving a lot of attention because they were devastated in the early 2020s by the COVID-19 pandemic, labor shortages, social unrest, war, and other shocks. Supply chain redesign enabled globalization, which reshaped the planet and transformed economies. Now, both executives and popular media talk about supply chains as battered and broken. The pandemic unveiled hidden vulnerabilities and showed us that many supply chains are unsustainable. Why weren't the world's supply chains agile and resilient in the early 2020s? It's a story of too much emphasis on one element. For decades, companies focused on lowering costs. They interpreted lean manufacturing principles as primarily reducing costs of labor and other inputs. As they maximized efficiency to take full advantage of economies of scale through globalization, there was little thought for error or for redundancy. They failed to sufficiently realize how much their success depended on stability. Today, companies operate in a VUCA world: volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. It's volatile because conditions change quickly. Pandemics erupt, wildfires blaze, ports close, neighboring despots invade. It's uncertain because at least some of these trends are nearly impossible to predict. Planners prefer certainty. The part will be here tomorrow at 9 a.m. But management, amid uncertainty, requires different skills. At the same time, the world is complex, with plenty of moving parts, many of them interdependent. Complexity requires backup plans and well-thought-out contingencies. Finally, the world is ambiguous because even when information is available, it can be interpreted in multiple ways. You may be tempted to jump at incorrect conclusions. At the height of globalization, people wanted to believe that the world would always evolve toward stability. But given recent events, it would be naive to wait for stability to magically return. So leaders should look for a strategy that will win in an uncertain world. Hence, the business world's recent focus on resilience, which is the ability to navigate the world by continuously sensing threats and proactively building contingencies. The crisis erupts, the part doesn't arrive on time, the implications ripple out, and the limited available information isn't easily interpreted. But you'll be okay. Your processes, people, and systems were built to handle this. Your operations are resilient. Resilience applies to all aspects of business, but it's especially relevant to supply chains for two reasons. First, as mentioned, most supply chains were built assuming a stable world and never reconfigured as markets turned increasingly volatile. If you can find a lower-cost supplier, make the change. The risks seem minimal. Now we are experiencing some of the risks. They're big. The need for expedited shipments and stockpiling makes costs explode. Stockouts lead to loss of revenue and loss of customers. Constant firefighting makes employees lose purpose and quit in droves. Now we have learned, if you can effectively address these risks and be more resilient than your competitors, you will gain advantage and win market share. Second, thinking about VUCA and supply chains highlights the role of operations. In the early 20th century, companies had to efficiently arrange their assembly lines and processes on the factory floor. This was the biggest key to their success. It was the age of operations. Then, through 20th century advances in marketing and technology, and an overall increase in prosperity, operations stepped back and focus shifted to enabling demand-driven strategies. The product gets made, whatever. Let's talk about how we'll advertise it. Now, we are at the cusp of another pivotal change. The pandemic didn't just disrupt supply chains. It gave a preview of vast disruptions to come. Some firms will navigate those disruptions by optimizing the flow of materials, cash, and information through global networks. Their resilience will provide them with greater profits than they would get by continuing to focus on costs or advertising or technology for its own sake. This is an exciting opportunity for executives. But reaching this level of resilience will require a lot of work. You need new operational strategies. You need to transform your operations to fulfill those strategies. And more than that, you need a new mindset that puts resilient operations at the heart of your company. Operations should shape corporate strategies. Resilience should shape corporate values. This book will show you how. It discusses core principles, shows how to put plans into practice, and examines how to respond to scenarios of the future. Its insights have arisen from our firm's work with clients, which we have frequently distilled into articles published as part of the Kearney Supply Chain Institute, KSCI. The book is anchored in five business principles of resilient operations. 1. Build resilience against supply shocks by empowering your supply base. 2. Build resilience against demand shocks by using your operations to create customer value. 3. Create resilient teams by leaning into new ways of working and the benefits of diversity. 4. Enable resilience through technology by combining human judgment with artificial intelligence. 5. Ensure long-term resilience by embracing sustainability. We're not claiming that any of these principles are earth-shatteringly new. Indeed, they've stood the test of time. Now they need to be applied across operations. Finding the right combination of these five principles that works for your specific firm will lead you to resilience and beyond. To operations that are regenerative and able to recover from any disruption or crises. Thus, will you ensure sustained success? In part one of this book, we lay out the strategy of how these five principles can be combined to drive your future profitability and growth. In part two, we go into more detail on how to implement resilience. For each principle, we provide five actions, from the tactical to the strategic, to bring that principle to life. We provide plenty of examples of real-life firms doing this work. Then in part three, we look to the future, laying out potential scenarios and showing how the principles can help you thrive despite uncertainty. When we talk about these business principles, it's not pie-in-the-sky platitudes. And when we talk about business transformation, it's something we ourselves have lived. We all work for Carney, the consulting firm. The firm's roots go back almost 100 years to the golden age of operations. Our founder, Tom Carney, helped companies address operational issues back then. And he had a reputation for rolling up his sleeves and walking around the factory floor. Tom's successors have been doing the same ever since. We are just the latest generation of operations aficionados who learn by helping our clients solve real-world problems. This book reflects our accumulation of that learning. We hope you get as much out of listening to it as we did writing it. Part 1. 5 Principles to Transform Your Operations Strategy. If it's not carefully defined, resilience risks becoming a meaningless buzzword. Indeed, a prior philosophy, lean, came to stand for all sorts of superficial and misapplied pieces of a framework that needed to be applied deeply and holistically. So let's be clear. Resilience is the ability to withstand risks. Those risks may come in various forms: supply, demand, internal, external, short-term, long-term, etc. So too might the forms of withstanding them: more transparency, better predictions, richer backup plans, quicker decision-making, etc. But a resilient company will be able to succeed amid tomorrow's risks better than a non-resilient one. Part 1 examines the 5 principles you can use to strengthen the resilience of your operations. Let's start by looking at why operations are so important and why they're so ripe for transformation. Chapter 1. Strong operations drive growth and profits by adjusting to an ever-changing world. The COVID-19 pandemic marked the end of an era. Pandemic effects rippled through supply and labor markets, geopolitical tensions mounted, and the climate crisis increasingly took its toll. We are experiencing the biggest remaking of the global economy since the end of World War II. As with other global rewirings, such as the Industrial Revolution, the unleashing of the internet, and the move to offshoring, the only thing we know for sure about this new business environment is that it will be less stable than the economic conditions of past decades. External conditions keep changing, and firms' operations struggle to keep up. Businesses are realizing that they need to be more flexible. They need resilience. Resilience across the value chain. Resilience is the ability to recover quickly from difficulties. Yet, in a fast-changing world, you should not recover to some previous state, because the previous state contributed to your disruption in the first place. The world will never go back to normal. In the new business reality, there is no normal anymore, only continual disruptions. Thus, businesses need to adapt quickly to any type of difficulty by proactively strengthening all links in the supply chain. To do this, they need a clear operations strategy that combines business, financial, and other strategies. Wider trends are bringing companies back to basics. How do your operations work, and how effectively can they adjust? This new imperative amounts to a fundamental restructuring of global value chains. Lean no longer reigns supreme. The philosophy is still important, especially in its original vision of balancing cost, efficiency, reliability, and resilience. But the old, single-minded focus on driving down costs resulted in rigid and brittle operations. To succeed in a post-pandemic world, companies must transform. Supply chains must be more agile. Operations must be more flexible and more sustainable. The definitions of operations and supply chain may seem self-evident, but let's take a moment to note their relationship. Your company starts by wanting to sell something to customers in markets. You create products and portfolios and plan for how to make them. Suppliers make inputs to your manufacturing sites, and then your logistics functions distribute products to customers, ideally with some customer service follow-up. In a narrow sense, the supply chain may be the only part between the two middle segments, suppliers and manufacturing. But really, the supply chain and all of these operations activities are components of a more holistic value chain. To build stronger, more agile supply chains, you can become more resilient at every step in this chain. You can prioritize responsiveness as well as cost and performance. Resilience and competitive advantage. Operations resilience was not necessarily valuable in the previous globalization paradigm. Then, competitive advantage often arose from customer focus or innovative products. Operations were seen as an enabler of the overall firm strategy, rather than a differentiator. To get the product to the customer as fast as possible and tailor it to their preferences. To get all required inputs to design and manufacture an innovative product. To be as efficient as possible, to keep costs low. Naturally, some firms did leverage operations strategy as a differentiator, often to achieve growth through cost leadership or shorter lead times. For example, in the 1970s, FedEx, then named Federal Express, revolutionized delivery with its then radical idea to fly almost all packages to Memphis and then back out again. In the 1980s, Toyota engaged in a David and Goliath battle with U.S. car makers, carrying only a slingshot in the form of its unique operational culture. In the 1990s, Walmart promised nationwide consumers ever lower prices, trusting that its attention to operations detail would make those prices profitable. In short, operations have previously been a path to profit and growth. What is different now is that we are experiencing supply chains breaking down on a never-before-seen scale due to intensifying global disruptions. We are moving from a global economy in which supply was generally available toward an economy of scarcity. The critical inputs didn't magically disappear. The new challenge lies much more in the allocation of goods. For example, transport systems have broken down due to the pandemic and related labor shortages. In the resulting congestion, critical goods cannot be delivered on time. Trade barriers and import quotas are on the rise as global sentiments become increasingly protectionist. Energy shortages and adverse weather events cause production outages and price hikes around the globe. These effects may eventually drive structural scarcity, rather than scarcity that varies by time and location. But for now, the main result is that global supply markets have become much more volatile. Can your firm respond to these conditions by creating operations excellence that goes beyond cost optimization? If so, you will secure logistics capacity, identify and develop critical suppliers, and plan for price hikes and supply failures. And you will be able to grow in this disruptive climate, while your less resilient competitors will wither. But only if you spend at least as much effort developing and ensuring supply as you already do developing and ensuring demand. Resilience as a differentiator amid crises. The 2020s so far have already presented crises in labor, raw materials, logistics capacities, and energy. In early 2020, people hoped that shortages would be a simple story involving temporary closures of Chinese factories. But as events played out, the pandemic caused on and off closures of factories worldwide, as well as ports, distribution centers, and other essential functions. Supply chains remained in crisis. Soon, other crises arrived. The Ukraine war had ripple effects on global flows of grain and natural gas. Increased U.S.-China tensions posed risks to supply bases. And climate change had ever more visible, ever more devastating effects. Suddenly, everything seemed more complex. Semiconductors became impossible to find. The supply chains for rare earth metals and pharmaceutical inputs clashed with environmental, social, and governance, ESG, goals. Ports became congested, and an entire fragile system became destabilized. Supply chain managers often found creative solutions, but in a world of the Great Resignation and quiet quitting, they risked burnout. Are these accumulating and concurrent crises just coincidence, just bad luck, just a new set of risks to anxiously track in gigantic spreadsheets? We believe that, on the contrary, they indicate deeper problems. Most companies' operations simply were not designed to handle this degree of volatility, and so it's time to change that operating model. The stakes are high. All companies seek unique strengths to drive profit and growth. Resilient operations are such a differentiator when implemented at the core of the firm. Since 2020, we at Kearney have seen highly differentiated financial returns for companies that have resilient operations. Specifically, we have worked with companies that have harvested low-hanging fruit, such as product segmentation or operational improvements within warehouses, to achieve benefits of a few percentage points of earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization, EBITDA. This book can help point you toward such projects, although you may already be familiar with some of them. What we really want to do in this book is put such projects in a wider framework and point out the benefits of moving holistically toward that framework. If you truly transform, as we have seen by supporting companies in broader transformations, you can achieve double-digit EBITDA growth. How do companies achieve such returns? First, they transform broader corporate strategy. Second, they transform themselves. Third, they transform the careers of the people who drive those changes. Operations as the path to profits. Many smart chief operations officers, COOs, are already addressing resilient operations. In a 2022 Kearney survey, 56% of leaders considered resilience a top five priority. Nearly 80% have embedded resilience into their decision-making processes, quantifying it as a key performance indicator, KPI. Nearly 85% are altering their manufacturing footprint by reshoring, nearshoring, and/or offshoring at a granular level. To address inflation, more than half have formed alliances with existing suppliers and embraced design thinking, rather than merely passing price increases on to consumers. Operations leaders can undertake projects to improve resilience at each step of the value chain. Why are they prioritizing resilience? You can think of the answer in two ways. First, the pandemic forced firms to rejigger their supply chains on the fly. Now COOs are seeing the benefits, so they're seeking to institutionalize the ideals that got them through the pandemic. The rejiggering created an ad hoc resilience, But now it's time to drive structural resilience deep into the firm. Second, leaders of the companies that employ those COOs have come to understand that operations are today's path to profits. In other words, they have seen the value of changing not only operations strategy, but also the company's values. Consider that by the end of the Cold War, many companies saw that globalization was the path to profits. You could move your supply chain to a low-cost country, and you could market your products to newly empowered consumers in newly opened economies. Those moves were worthwhile because they boosted profits, but they were also responses to external changes, newly available labor forces and consumers, thanks to the opening of the formerly communist world. These moves also changed companies' values. Maybe they made you more cost-focused, more aware of shareholder desires to keep expenses down. Maybe they made you more global, better able to pay attention to the varying needs of diverse global customers. Maybe they enabled you to provide opportunities for talented global employees to collaborate. These changes in values were good and necessary, because they represented your journey on the path to profits. You're always on a path to profits. Sometimes external changes dictate slight deviations, as in the late 1990s, when the path needed to go through the internet. Sometimes there's a blockage, as in the aftermath of the 2008 financial crisis, when it had to detour through fiscal management. If you didn't adjust your values to these detours, if you try to operate analog in a digital world, or with 1990s bookkeeping in the 2010s, your company would be in trouble. Today's detour is even bigger. Today's myriad disruptions represent the risks of the globalized world catching up with us. We built our distribution systems without awareness of chaos theory. We built our economic assumptions without sufficient contemplation of how a pandemic could threaten them. We built our transportation and power systems by assuming away the effects of burning all that carbon. But now we should know better. We know that with a 6% vaccination rate in the world's poorest 52 countries, future pandemics are possible. Indeed, the current one may not be over. We know that ballooning global public debt to GDP ratios at 97% in 2020 could create debt crises or other risks to economic recovery. We know that many countries worry about erosion of social cohesion, especially given the likelihood of exacerbating income disparities. And we know the risks of a changing climate, floods, wildfires, and other extreme weather events being only the most obvious. If you try to operate lean in this risky world, your company will be in trouble. However, if your resilient operations mean that you can deliver when your competitor can't, you win market share. Your journey will even take you to unexpected, wonderful places. What might that look like? Some examples. You move operations closer to customers, and in that reshoring effort, you discover design modifications that save you money. You leverage data analytics and artificial intelligence, AI, to bring the voice of the customer throughout your organization and gain the ability to make smarter, quicker decisions. You embrace sustainability as a core principle, implementing it across all functions of your company and its supply chain, and discover new sustainable designs that lead to new customers and new growth. To be successful in such a journey to profitability, you must commit fully to it. You must transform your company with resilient operations at its core. Of course, your journey will be unique to your company. But five core principles describe success in our new VUCA world. You'll probably use some combination of them. Five principles of operational excellence. A resilient supply chain can perceive what is happening internally and externally, and quickly and continuously adapt to those conditions. We like to use the phrase sense and pivot. First, you sense external signals. Maybe demand is shifting. Maybe supply is becoming scarce. Then you pivot internally. You adapt your plan and strategy on the fly to better fit the new reality. You are performing against both your plan and the unplannable. Your dynamic responses make you adaptable. At the same time, you're improving your capabilities to digitize and automate, improving the speed and efficiency of your response. Indeed, Carney does a great deal of work these days with our resilience stress test, a customized study of a company's performance on selected resilience indicators across 8 dimensions, such as geography, suppliers, and outbound logistics. Companies use the test as a tool to focus, prioritize, and accelerate their resilience-building efforts. They look across 5 performance dimensions: cost, cash, service, resilience, and sustainability. We encourage them to identify and work on their weak spots, such as inadequate planning processes, over-reliance on select overseas geographies, or lack of product platform and manufacturing flexibility. Sometimes that involves reshoring. People sometimes think of pivot only in terms of suppliers, pivoting from one supplier to another. But the ability to pivot is valuable in responding to all types of risks throughout the value chain. For example, when Warby Parker encouraged online customers to order multiple designs of the same eyeglasses, returning the ones they didn't like, it was enhancing its ability to pivot on the customer dimension. Likewise, a pharmaceutical company might invest in seamless omnichannel distribution to pivot in the face of advances or disruptions in logistics. This book is a strategic tour of these principles. Although this format doesn't permit us to individualize the analysis to your specific situation, we can share with you what we've learned. We believe the message is clear. You must make your operations more resilient, and you can make your operations more resilient. This is how you build advantage. Resilience and reshoring. Where do reshoring and nearshoring fit into resilient operations? For many companies, the emergence of risks has prompted a desire to bring operations closer to home. If you're starting from that instinct, you may be impatient with our ideas about resilience and pivoting. We certainly agree that reshoring is extremely important. You can't trust a global supply chain as much as the world previously thought. In the current global situation, dependencies on distant geographies and uncertain politics are a huge issue. Your pursuit of resilience will likely cause you to reshore or nearshore some of your operations. But which operations? You can't reshore everything. You have to think through the risks and benefits. When we say that the previous paradigm was too focused on reducing costs, we're not saying that costs are irrelevant. We're saying that you need to balance costs against other factors. And we believe the best way to summarize those factors is operations resilience. For example, a 10% cost savings looks good for the procurement department. But if you achieve it at the risk of losing 10% of your sales due to disruptions and supply shortages, it may not be worthwhile. Of course, those risks are hard to quantify. But it seems quite clear that they are increasing. At minimum, you certainly need to analyze them. That's what the resilience lens can do for you. Thus, each of the principles in this book may contribute to a reshoring/nearshoring decision. Working through the principles could help you decide to change the location of a certain function because it provides you with more resilience against supply shocks, or against demand shocks, or both. Reshoring could help you build better teams, improve technology, enhance sustainability, or all or none of these options. The point is that rather than starting from a desire to reshore, you can start from a framework that helps you make these and other decisions. Because the point isn't reshoring for its own sake. The point is reshoring in support of resilient operations. Insights become principles. Mastering operations resilience is clearly possible. Tools to address it include a holistic risk operating model, software packages and AI solutions, a commitment to transparency, and old-fashioned human ingenuity. But mastery doesn't happen on its own. It happens only when a company's leadership gives attention, focus, and talent to operational challenges. Which challenges? We looked across operations to identify the areas with the most promise of return on investment. You could think of them as the fundamentals of resilient operations, or the areas of particular disruption, or the initiatives where we have noticed firms making particular progress. They can be summarized as supply chain, customers, employees, technology, and sustainability. Of course, there's overlap among them, and of course, not every fundamental applies in every situation. Our purpose here is to lay out a philosophy of interacting with the VUCA world. As you design your own corporate strategy, you will pick, choose, and combine among these areas. We distilled our insights in these areas into 5 business principles. They're not new, nor should they be. Instead, their value comes from applying them to the risky business situations that require resilience. Here are the 5 principles. 1. Build resilience against supply shocks by empowering your supply base. 2. Build resilience against demand shocks by using your operations to create customer value. 3. Create resilient teams by leaning into new ways of working and the benefits of diversity. 4. Enable resilience through technology by combining human judgment with artificial intelligence. 5. Ensure long-term resilience by embracing sustainability. We'll discuss each in more detail in subsequent chapters, and we'll include examples of companies embracing resilience. Each example centers on a leading principle, but it also shows how the principles often combine. Because, let's reemphasize, this is a journey. You won't just issue an edict encouraging the firm to focus on operations. And you won't abandon your previous strengths, be they unique products, or structural cost advantages, or powerful relationships. Instead, similar to a hero setting off on a quest, you will take these and other, perhaps not yet realized, strengths to new lands. You will face surprising threats and seemingly impossible challenges. You may at times question your wisdom in setting out on the journey. You will almost surely end it with a different inner character than when you started. But if you do indeed navigate the challenges, you will be hugely successful. Let's dive in. Chapter 2. Principle 1. Build resilience against supply shocks by empowering your supply base. Vanishing semiconductors demonstrate supply chain breakdowns. The story of semiconductors in automobiles may be the best example of how the pandemic revealed broken supply chains. Most people know the basics. When COVID-19 hit, demand for new cars came to a virtual standstill. To save money and protect workers, automakers closed factories and canceled orders. Their suppliers thus did the same, and so did their suppliers, all up to the foundries manufacturing the base silicon wafers needed for computer chips. After they closed, the foundries needed time to ramp back up to their capacity. And as they did so, they focused on their highest margin products. In particular, they saw increased demand for home appliances and expansion of 4G, 5G networks. Then, when demand for new cars suddenly shot up in the fourth quarter of 2020, automakers couldn't find the semiconductors they needed. Nearly all automakers had to curtail production. New car inventories dropped by as much as 70%. With too little supply to meet demand, sales dropped by as much as 54%. The situation smacked all the weaknesses of lean manufacturing methods. Automakers reduced costs by reducing inventory. Then they ran out of inventory. They squeezed suppliers for every last penny. Then they found themselves squeezed. They pushed risks ever farther upstream. Then they found those risks had flowed everywhere downstream. The fault lay with a system, not any individual company. One problem was that semiconductors were in everything. Vehicle microcontrollers, as well as door locks, sophisticated automatic transmissions, as well as bun-warming seat heaters. Even automakers with many different Tier 1 and Tier 2 suppliers found that those suppliers depended on the same chip foundries upstream. Another problem was also that automakers preferred semiconductors of a 200-millimeter wafer size, an older design that was cost-effective and reliable, rather than graduating to the newer and superior 300-millimeter wafer. In other words, rigid technology specs made for dependence on an obsolete product that was a low priority for foundries. But complicated engineering made it hard for automakers to switch. A third problem was a complex and geographically dispersed supply chain. Many semiconductors make the equivalent of 3 full trips around the world, crossing international borders 70 or more times in the manufacturing process. One reason automakers had thrived in the previous outsourcing era was that they had a great deal of power over suppliers. But as automobile design became more complex, more digitized, and more semiconductor-dependent, the power dynamics reversed. The Tesla Model 3, for example, has 3.5 times the semiconductor elements as an average 2017 car. Although Tesla, starting its engineering from scratch, was able to avoid some of the crisis. At the same time, demand for semiconductors, often 200-millimeter wafers, also exploded from non-automotive industries, such as companies making equipment to work with the Internet of Things. Then the foundries faced what were common to be seen as normal supply chain issues: U.S.-China political tensions, logistical disruptions, a blizzard in Texas, a factory fire in Japan, and the Ukraine war constricting the supply of a neon gas essential to the manufacturing process. Automakers, with their deliberately downsized storage capacities and short order lead times, were only able to respond to a limited extent. They were largely dependent on the actions of their suppliers, to whom they had transferred the risks and responsibility for supply chain. Worse, some automakers lacked transparency. They found out too late that their Tier 1 suppliers could not deliver the products that their assembly lines needed. But it's important not to blame automakers, because the problem wasn't theirs, or at least not theirs alone. The problem was a system that left all decision-makers with few good options in a crisis. And the crisis isn't just pandemic. The problem is that such a brittle system can be overwhelmed by crises big or small, medical or geopolitical, related to semiconductors or any other tiny but essential input. This is a lack of resilience. A company struggles to respond to the crisis of the pandemic, and then struggles to respond to an unexpected surge in demand, and then struggles to respond to the ongoing crises that seem par for the course these days. One way to build resilience against the next supply shock is to restructure your brittle supply chains so that they bend instead of breaking, so that the pressures are distributed across the network instead of concentrated at single-source dependencies. One automaker bucked trends, delaying impacts from the semiconductor crisis. Toyota. You may find that surprising, given that Toyota is so closely associated with lean manufacturing and just-in-time inventory management. But after the 2011 Tohoku earthquake, Toyota doubled the value of inventory it carried. Its rich communication with suppliers led it to keep up to 4 months of stock for crucial components such as semiconductors. Its oft misunderstood interpretation of lean manufacturing is not so much about reducing costs as it is paying attention to supply chains. Part of that attention included working to identify and minimize risks. Toyota didn't avoid the crisis. Shortages extended so long that it eventually felt impacts along with everyone else. But its initial response showed more resilience than many competitors. As Toyota's example shows, to deal with disruptions, you need to lean into resilience. Yet because disruptions are so varied, you need not just scraps of resilient behavior, but a philosophy of resilience that guides all of your operations. Rather than squeezing profits out of a rigid, low-cost supply chain, companies need to empower an integrated ecosystem of collaborative suppliers. Empowered suppliers build resilience. To improve resilience, you can start by changing your view of suppliers. They are a source of value. Rather than seeing your supply chain as something you construct out of meaningless individual chain links, envision your suppliers as partners. They need to be strong, because without them, you can't build a strong supply chain. Sure, you may be thinking, you're talking about supplier relationship management, SRM. Yes and no. You do need relationships with your suppliers, and those relationships will be stronger when you manage them. But some people seem to think that SRM is all about bashing vendors over the head until they reduce the price another 4%. That's not a relationship. Those people are practicing supplier abuse management. As in any relationship, SRM involves communication on the executive level to understand the problems of the other party. For example, Rational, a company that makes equipment for professional kitchens, won the 2022 overall category for Kearney's Factory of the Year program by working in very close collaboration with suppliers. Rational's SRM focuses on technologies, quality criteria, and building long-term trust, so that suppliers are willing to make mutually beneficial investments. Rational's supplier fitness programs are about managing growth together. For example, if Rational needs suppliers to commit to higher volumes, it sends experts to help implement and optimize to ensure that development is sustainable for all parties. Do your suppliers help you with design? Are they involved in open collaboration with teams at your company or teams at your other suppliers? Have you given them the visibility they need to make smart and profitable decisions? When you ask these types of questions, you know you're in a relationship. It's managing these issues, collaboration, transparency, satisfaction. That's the heart of your SRM. Why? Because your suppliers are a source of value, and you need to maximize that value, not minimize the cost. We're not saying don't pay attention to costs, just don't pay attention only to costs. For example, when a global food business decided to reduce packaging costs, it shared detailed cost and complexity models with its packaging suppliers. That sparked collaborative ideation that not only further reduced costs, but also improved packaging sustainability. Indeed, for key suppliers, they should be more than sources of value. They should be partners. You are on a journey to resilience, and you want one or more suppliers to join you on this journey. This requires a new mindset. Rather than being transactional, your relationship with this supplier is one of trust. You trust them, they trust you. The top leadership of your firm invests the time and money required to build up that trust. Trust is always a two-way street. You may help suppliers in their time of need, trusting that they will help you come your own crises. They may ask to see your sales and operations planning, S&OP, details, trusting that you will fix anything that's wrong. After all, if you have S&OP issues, your suppliers often pay the price, but lack the power to fix them. You may ask to see your suppliers' books, knowing that they will trust you not to negotiate on cost. Instead, you want to see where they are struggling and how a joint effort might allay that struggle. For example, if they're struggling with their own suppliers, you may be able to help with negotiations or re-engineering. You certainly can't do this with all suppliers. Your engineers are going to travel to their site. Your chief procurement officer, CPO, is going to meet with their CEO, and even your CEO will ideally meet their CEO. Obviously, this is only for major suppliers of huge quantities on multi-million dollar contracts. The benefit of bringing in the CPO or CEO, rather than a category manager, is that you may be able to get a longer-term contract. Yet even as you build this trust with major suppliers, you can let that new attitude spill over to other relationships. You can seek to establish a cooperative culture towards suppliers in general. Note that it's the job of the C-suite to cultivate this culture. Resilience is about strengthening the links in your chain. Building trust with key suppliers provides the strength. Thus, empowering suppliers builds resilience. When they're resilient, the next crisis won't break them. It won't tempt them to move to other customers. And thus, it won't break you. End-to-end thinking builds resilience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.